If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, you may be also. And whether I go, you know, and the way you know. Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whither you go, and how can we know the way? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. Believest thou this? Amen.
Flee. I raise a hallelujah. middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Thank you.
Amen. If we could get all those folk in the back there, let's get them seated. There's plenty of room. As they say in the old days, sit like you got a family. There's plenty of room. Please come on in and be seated. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ushers, please get those folk in out of the lobby and get the foyer and get them seated. Yeah. Those folk by that door, the double doors right there, come on in, because that's the main entrance and people are trying to get in. So please come on in. To see so many people come out today and to wish this family well and to see the effect that Sister Janice had on a lot of people. Yes, sir. Come on in. Come on in. Come on in. Started now. I see everybody's coming in. Let's get these last few people seated and then we'll be ready to go. And the people said, and the people said again, and the people said one more time. Now put your hands together, give the Lord a mighty hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. We are here to celebrate the memory of Janice Diane Bryant. I've been knowing her for almost 50 years and never knew her middle name was Diane. And I kept that secret from you, amen. I was looking at her children and I was thinking, we've come a long way since 21st Avenue South. Back in the day, yes, I've been knowing this family a long time, and this is a special occasion for me because I've never had to do a service for a person that I've known this long, and for a person that I've known not only this long, but I've known her children all of their lives from the time they were born. There's a couple of them I might not want to know about that, but then there's a couple of them that are all right. So, but anyway, but I've known this family a long time, and I am really I got kind of mixed emotions right about now, because I was her pastor, and I think even before I was her pastor, even before I acknowledged my call to preach, we were neighbors, and we were friends for a long time. So, but I have to trust God, and I believe that whatever he does right. And I believe that whatever he does for our good, even though we don't see the good in it at the time. Amen. So we are here to, again, to celebrate the memory of Janice Bryant and to get some words of encouragement from the Lord as we process now the rest of our lives without her. I'm going to get to what we're going to do in a few minutes, but now memory comes back to me. I remember when my mother passed away. And as I was sitting at the graveyard, and as they were lowering her casket into the ground, the Spirit of God sat next to me. And he told me, he said, Ellis, he says, now I'm going to show you that I can be a mother for you too. And so I've been believing that and trusting that, and he has filled those shoes quite adequately. And I'm sure her children understand that implicitly because they love Jesus. And they know that he would take that spot and he would do a very good job, and the grandchildren and also. We thank and praise God for giving us a little while with Janice. We thank you for her loudness. Amen. I like a person who loves Jesus, but they are themselves. I don't like people who are phony. And I'm going to miss that about her, because she would scream my name out no matter where she saw me. Especially at Tropicana Field. And everybody will look around, wonder who she's screaming at, and there I am, she's talking to me. So, but God bless you guys for coming. And yeah, so what we want to do tonight, it's a lot of you here. And we want to give some people an opportunity to say some things to the family. I need for you though to keep in mind that we only have a short time frame to do this. And the family has asked that you try to keep it at 2 minutes. So I'm going to ask this. Please, no solos tonight. No poems. And no dissertations. Amen? For the family's sake. But we've reserved some time because I need to have a few minutes to speak a couple of words from the Lord to you so that you can continue to move on in the direction that he has you going in. So what we're going to do is there's a microphone to my right, your left, right here. And we've reserved it. So whoever wants to say something to the family in regards to maybe a memory or some words of encouragement, we're going to give you an opportunity to do that. I have a time frame in mind. So, again, it's not possible for everyone. And tomorrow it won't be possible for everyone because the family has already written out a program and they've asked me to make sure that the program goes according to the way it's written. And I told them that I would do that. So if you're here tonight and you want to say something to the family, words of encouragement or something of a memory of Janice, or it's your time now to come. Again, to my right, your left, there's a microphone right there. If you would just step right there and remember, try to keep it within a minute and a half if possible. If you go longer than that, I will touch you on the shoulder. Amen. So is there anyone here tonight that would like to start a ball? It will probably be polite if we let the family members go first. It would kind of be polite if we let the immediate family. Is there anybody in the immediate family other than the children who would like to say something tonight? I'll wait. Okay. You can go now. We'll let the children and then the rest of the immediate family come first. There's some over here in this corner too. There's plenty of seats.
I just want to say that I thank you all for coming out, celebrating the life of my mother. I know she kept smiles on a lot of people's face and made you laugh and make you do all kind of cheers and scream back at her. My mom had the opportunity to stay with me for a year. And during that time, we became, well, we were already close, so I'm not going to tell that story. But she was able to stay with me in my adult years, my more settled years. She bonded with my husband. Her and my son became best friends. We enjoyed our time with her. And when my mom left me, she didn't tell me she was leaving me. She just said, I'm going home and I'm going to go to the doctor. And she never came back. And her room is still the same. Her clothes are still in the closet. All her Naomi stuff is still on the shelves. She got salt packages everywhere, sugar packages everywhere. All her purses are still in the same spot. And I think I'm going to leave them there just for a little while longer. But I'm going to miss her a whole lot. I wake up in the morning and I call my mom every day. I talk to her every day. And when my mom was sick, I FaceTime her. She only kept her phone just so she could talk to her children. And she'll tell, after she talked to us, she'll tell Auntie Joyce to take the phone because she didn't want to talk anymore. But I'm going to miss my talks with her, my FaceTimes with her, just calling her and gossiping, telling everybody business. Last time I went and picked my mom up from the hospital, we were on our way home, and she said, I'm not ready to go home. And so I was like, Mama, my mom was on oxygen. And I said, Mama, your tank not going to last that long. She said, we're not going home. Take me to my sister's house. That's the first stop. We pulled up at Auntie Joy's house. Auntie Joy said, y'all got to go home. Go ahead, Kim, go home. She said, no, Kim, I want to go to Walmart. I said, Mama, wait a minute. Now, you're not getting out at Walmart. I'm going to run in and get what you need. And you're going to stay in the car while I run in. I come back out. There's three people at the car. Mom finds people to talk to wherever she is. So we leave Walmart, and a good friend of mine was here for her bridal shower. She said, no, we're not going home. Take me to see Quan. I said, Mama, no, I got to tell her. I'm sorry, I missed a bridal shower. I got to go see her. So I took her all the way over to Pinellas Point to see Quan. We out there talking. I hear her breathing hard. I turn around. Mama, your oxygen tank is about to be empty. We got to go home. No, just try to drive a little bit longer. She wanted to just keep driving, keep seeing, and keep looking for people that she can just say hello to. We finally got home, and that was her last weekend home. And I'm gonna miss her really, really bad. And to my sister and my brother, we did a great job. Yeah. We did a great job. To my special care team people, you all did a great job. I can call you all in the middle of the night and you show up. I can call Auntie until I can't be at this hospital by myself and she'll show up. I thank you all. I thank you all. Auntie Deb, Auntie Besa, Mama Dina. Mama Dina, I don't know where she at, but Mama Dina, Christiane, Carla, all of you that showed up, I thank you. I thank you so much. I guess my time up, but again, thank thank you again, and I'm glad you all are out to celebrate my dang, I got music. Bye, y'all.
You know I'm coming behind you. I just want to say thank you to everybody for coming out to me. I'm not going to have a sad story because my mama turned up and she lived life the fullest. So I'm asking everybody, after you get your 1, 2, 10 in, I need you to turn up for my mama tonight because she had fun. If you came through my house, you had fun, and she want to see you have fun. So I might cry a little bit, but I'm going to be strong because she told me in the hospital she don't want y'all to cry. All right? Love y'all.
Hello, I'm Jacquette, Janice's favorite niece, sorry, for all my nieces and cousins. But anyways, I got a story. We always went to Essence every year, my auntie. We partied, but this one particular time we went to Essence. We went to go see Frankie Beverly and Maids. That's her favorite people. Oh my God, we sat there all night for them to sing. We about to go to sleep, they sang, she don't wanna leave. So it was over, we get to the hotel. Frankie Beverly Mays was at our hotel. So auntie say, I ain't going upstairs. I'm waiting for Frankie and Beverly Mays to come. We like, auntie, that man done gone to bed. Me and my auntie sat in that lobby till almost 4 o'clock in the morning, waiting for Frankie and Beverly Mays to come. So finally, she asked the security, where's Frankie Beverly Mays? They say, he done went down the elevator. He already in the bed. And she like, you sure? He was like, yeah. She did not want to leave that lobby. Me and her sat down there all night long waiting for Frankie. But they never came. But I'm going to miss my auntie. I love her dearly. I could talk to her about anything, anytime. She going to ask you, well, what's going on with you? Tell me. You okay? She want to know all your business. And you better tell her all your business. But thank y'all, and I love y'all.
Well, the other two got up and I felt guilty. I guess the oldest have to get up. First, before I get started, I just want to give honor to my father. If it wasn't for him, I don't know where I would be. I thank you for giving me peace that passes all understanding. And I have to thank my godparents for holding us up. Not only during this difficult time, but my entire 51 years. And thank you, God Daddy, for doing what I say when I say do it. Thank you, God Mommy, for making sure he do what I say when I say do it. And Kim wants to make sure I tell y'all thank you. She didn't want to push me up. And then the second person I want to thank is my Auntie Linda. She called me every day, twice a day. And I'm going to miss my mom. I talk to my mom every day. I live in Washington, D.C., and it takes me 45 minutes to get from my workplace to my home. And she was my call to get me home. Who am I going to call now? Who want to talk to me for 45 minutes? But again, guys, thank you for all your support, all your love, and we really appreciate it. And I love each and every one of you, but God loves you best.
Whoa, okay, I'm so sorry. To my doctor, I'm so sorry. I appreciate you calling, getting every piece of information for your godmom. I thank you for your knowledge. I thank you for your understanding, and I thank you for your support. I appreciate you being my doctor away from Atlanta. I thank you. I thank you so much, bestie. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name's Kenneth McTeer. My sweet, my beautiful, my loud cousin. And I'm going to leave you with that. I had the beautiful, beautiful years of being able to spend time with her at her point, Lakewood Field. And if anybody know Lakewood Field, you would know Janice. So I'm going to keep mine brief. And I'm going to leave you with a little Janice.
I gotta follow that.
Praise God. We are the progressive class of 1973. If y'all ain't up here, y'all come on up here, stand up, let people know. This ain't me, this all of us. And she's one of the reasons that we are all of us. She was one of our very strong forces. She held us together, and we came through at probably one of the more challenging times. We paved the way for some of the youngsters, and we tried to follow our elders and do it properly. The elders taught us just enough to get by, and we were tight. We were split up, done wrong, but we had the love that kept us together, and she was one of the main reasons. So we are here to show our love, our support, and we ain't all gonna take 2 minutes, but we just wanna say, Janice, we love you, and we'll miss you. Anybody else?
Hey fans, if your team makes you proud, then shout your name out loud. Shout your name out loud.
So look, back in the time where you played with a team and you stayed with that team until you progressed off, back in the old days, back when it was Geneva, Ezel, Brenda, Matasha, Miss Graham, Amelia, back when Pistol had a Jerry curl, there was the one, Janice Bryant. Now, she'd be there all day, every day, and you knew her voice when you heard it. And if them cheerleaders weren't cheering like they were supposed to, she would say the cheer, and then the cheerleaders would look and be like, well, I guess we're going to do that cheer now. And then they keep going. And if the cheerleaders wouldn't do it, then the crowd going to do it. And don't let it be a St. Pete Lakewood rivalry. Oh, it's on now. We don't have it like that no more. But understand, anybody who know from that generation, notice Janice Bryant. Now, from my area, my neighborhood, well, all us used to play in the yard. We all played football, courtesy of Lucius and LaJuan playing football, and they used to teach us how to play football, but it went for Janice them signing them up, none of us probably would have played. So if you fast forward how your track goes in life, she signed them up. I asked her to sign me up, because I thought she just signed everybody up, and she was like, oh, no, you got to have your mama do that. Okay. Time progressed, my mama did do that. But understand, they taught me, I played, I became a coach, and 23 years later, I'm still coaching, and all the kids that have been impacted from coaching. Understand, there's always a level up, and if you can actually track who begets the begetting, you can see where everything blows up. So, with that being said, thank you, Janice. You reached about 2,000 kids, courtesy of you trying to get your boys to play football and them teaching me. So thank you. And Lloyd, You always say you want people, you want the rocks to cry out for you? No, you ain't got to worry about them rocks. You got Janice, because she going to cheer for you all day, every day. Thank you, Janice.
Boy, is there anyone else? I didn't know this was going to come into Comedy Central, but it is. Is there anyone else? There's someone way over there. Come on forward.
Hi, my name is Ken. I was one of a few of Janice's managers at Tropicana Field with the Rays. And I know she absolutely loved her job there, and she loved the people with us. I had the fortune of knowing Janice for 26 years. So lovely, lovely lady. And the thing that I remember most about her that's always resonated is her faith, her family, and then her friends. And she's always been such a good friend to so many of us at Tropicana Field. And I tell you, it's funny, I heard some of it. She was loud, and she was funny. She was one of the funniest people I've met. But in terms of her loudness, there was one time when I joked around with her. My office is up on the second floor, and she's down in the box office on the first floor. And I came over there and I said, geez, Janice, I could hear you from my office up there. And but one of the couple funny things that I remember about her, about our relationship, is when in the first year, we would sell at the windows, and we took a lot of cash at the windows. And I would go through each person to see if we need to make change for them. And of course, you know, I'd get to Janice about fifth or sixth in there, and I'd see bags of chips and ham sandwiches and stuff like that in there. But then, you know, I said, well, how much money you got in here? And I'd look at it, and I'd say to her, layoffs are coming. And she always loved that. We always joked around about that. And then fast forward to a couple years ago, when we were really going with digital ticketing and everything, we're doing less at the window, but she transformed into a role where she was helping people get the tickets up on their app and everything. And when we first started it, we had a lot of people that were having troubles with it. And Janice, with her friendly personality, was always helping people, willing to help. But it was funny. We got to a point where, like, when someone finally got it, she'd say, praise Jesus, they got it. On to the next one. So just really enjoyed her, and, you know, blessed to the family. And she was a super lady, and she's a great friend. And I think, you know, in her recent days, obviously being sick, I think that my personal feeling is, because of her strong faith, she was able to deal with that and look forward to her next trip and journey. And I think we should, like when Karen Jones told me that first, you know, she was taking a turn for the worse, and then she came in and told me that she had passed. You know, of course, I was very sad because I'm losing my friend. But then it was weird. About 2 minutes later, maybe less than that, I started smiling because I just remembered just what a great lady that she was and how she made me feel. So thank you, Janice. We love you. So.
Is there anyone else? Come on.
I have 2 minutes, and I'm going to try my best to do my 2 minutes. I'm not going to sing. I just wanted to say I knew Janice for over, I guess it had to be over 40 years. And I know she had this grandson, they called him Trey. He was out there on that field, and she would have everybody to sign up for the field. She even had me signing up my daughter for the cheerleading. But Janice was just like that. Even at work, she would be there, La Gloria. First, let me back up. We got laid off from Allstate. When I first got hired at Allstate, I went to go for my interview, and I had to go to the ladies' room. I went in the ladies' room. Janice was in there. She said, "What's your name?" And I told her. Yeah, so it's like, and I told her, I say, they said I had to go out here to this clinic out there on Fifth Avenue North. Oh, well, you got the job. You got the job. Okay. So I put in about 16 years there at Allstate, right? Get laid off at Allstate when they were downsized. And then I got a job downtown to St. Pete Times. In the interview, the manager say, You from Allstate? I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "You know a girl named Janice Bryant?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Well, she's going to be the one that's going to train you." So here we go again. I just know Janice. To know Janice is to know Janice. And just like you said, she was all up in your business, you know. But you had to decide whether you were going to tell her all your business, because she didn't tell you all her business. But I'm going to miss her so much. And the only thing about this is my sister. I had a sister that passed away. She's in Clearwater, and they're going to have her service next weekend. So that's why I wasn't able to come, you know, to see about you all right now. But I pray that y'all would just lift y'all heads up, because she's cheering. And when I told my son about Janet, he said, "That's the cheerleader for the Lakewood." I said, "Yes, that's her." So she's cheering up there in heaven.
Hello, everybody. I met Janice at a regional convention. I was 6 months clean, 22 years ago, in Fort Myers. Pop brought her there. I met Pop when I first came into recovery of Cocaine Anonymous. Pop had went home and told her, "Man, we got us a new person, and she act like she wants to stay clean. She talk. So I finally met Jan at this convention, first convention, and when she saw me, and he introduced us, and then she had like she knew me for years, you know. Janice always invited me every time when she had Sunday for Pop, his anniversary is, it's my birthday party, she come knock on my door. She don't give me a choice to say yes or no. You guys, she said, I am having Pop a surprise party, and you guys to come. Don't think about it, you are coming. If you don't have a way, I will come and pick you up." She said because he loves you and she loved me too. Then she told me that and she loved me too. She knew how he felt about me and my recovery. And I told her one time, I thank her for allowing her husband to be in my life for my recovery. You do not find too many women like that.
Yeah, that's right.
I gave her the utmost respect. I still respect her today. I'm going to miss her. Every time she sees me, she always asks me, "Am I okay? Do I need anything?" Because if I tell her yes, she's going to send Pop around to my house and make sure that he do what he need to do for me and my kids. Now, she did that. So somebody asked me, "Was I coming here to her awakening?" I said, "Yes, I got to come." She wouldn't have it no other way. You know, sometimes you have to be there for people, whether you want to or not. But I didn't say yes. I never said no. But I'm going to miss Janet, because last time I saw her at a funeral about last year sometime. She was glad to see me. She gave me a hug and everything. And she told me that she loved me. I told her I love her too. And then she had to go to work. So she asked us to make sure that we take care of Pop and bring Pop back home. And we did that. You know, all of us did that. So, yeah, she's going to be missed. I really am going to miss her truly, you know. So thank you, everybody.
Is there anyone else? Is there anyone else? Get up.
Good evening, everyone. I just had not to say that about my sister. I know her since I was 15 years old, 16 years old. I know her for years. We got so much history together, so many stories, good, bad, happy, and sad, cry tears, laugh tears. Our children issues, we want to kill them together. We don't like them today, but we love them tomorrow. We got stories that we share. We some of my porch men, my sister Benita, me and my sister Dap, me and my sister Dap, me and my sister Patricia, we call her Boo. We have another girlfriend, her name was Janice. We would sit on my porch at night. Janice don't like to go home. She want to sit all night. When you go to her house, she don't want you to leave. Well, you ain't got to go, Boo. Sit right there. We got a little more story to tell. I'm tired. I got to go home. I got to go to work in the morning. Then my brother comes out to the door. He peeping because he knows as well. Papa, her husband. I love her dearly. I got stories that I came again to tell. But there was beautiful story and beautiful memory. And trust me, we got mad like sisters at each other. Trust me, we did. And then we'll get back and talk and apologize and love each other. But the last journey I had with her, I would have not missed it for the world. I would pay jewels to have did it again. And I would did it as long as she has lived, because she earned the love and the respect that she gave out to people. Those journeys I did on her is precious. And I always remember her, who she were, and the day that she closed her eyes and said, I'm coming home to see my son and father open the gates of heaven. And now she's there, and she's at peace and no more suffering on this earth. And I would do it again. Thank you for listening.
Giving honor to God, amen. My name Irene, and I want to talk on the behalf of Janice in Mahalo's fashion troupe. She loved it marching in that troupe. Janice and I have been friends since I was 12 years old, marching down Central Avenue in the parade with Mahalo. And as a matter of fact, Janice did the last show with my husband on March 31st, 2018. I got a picture up there in my living room. So Janice will always be my star. Y'all can see I'm nervous. I can't even hardly talk. But on the behalf of the Mahalo Fashion Troupe, we thank y'all for allowing her to spend her time to be able to model with us. Kim, Kiki, Lamont. I spent a lot of time with Kiki and Kim coming up, and Lucius, who told me when he was 3 years old he was gonna marry me, didn't he, Kim? Didn't he say it, Kim? So I've always teased Janice, I'm not just your friend, honey, I'm your daughter-in-law too, and we the same age.
Wow. Is there anyone else? We have time for a few more, just a few more. Anyone else? Anyone else? Well, thank you so very much. Give yourself a big round of applause. Are you coming? One more. One more.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Valerie Oliver. I am William Oliver's mother, Kim Oliver's mother-in-law. Yes, yes, yes. I'm not a big speaker, but, you know, when you look, sometimes God put people together. But with this, he put family together. And just meeting Kim and Jeff getting together, we call him Jeff, it was just like God just said, this family belongs to all of you. I can remember when they got married, I can remember Janice with her big hat. I can remember her gray suit And she came walking down the aisles, and I knew that that was the person I loved. And then we had the opportunity of having her in Atlanta, just for a little while. It was not a stranger that she met. We would go somewhere together. She'd have a whole conversation with a person I've never seen before. And you're trying, come on, babe, I'm coming. You know, it's like, we know Janice. But I just want to say on the day, I just wanted to talk to her to say, hold on, hold on, hold on. And when I got ready to talk to her, something just said to me, this is my will. I only thing I could say with her, I love you, I love you, I love you. And that's all I can say. And I want to say to Janice, I want to say first to the family, I still love all of you. And to her, I love you. She is my sister. And thank you so much. And you are my brother, and I haven't seen you.
Is there anyone else? Is there anyone else? There's some people standing in the back there. Ushers, can we find some seats for them? On that far side over here, there's some seats. I'm sure there's some spaces in here somewhere. There's one seat right down here on the corner. You can come down and sit there. Yeah.
Well, thank you. Lord, thank you. I really don't even know, like, how to start. My name is Dennis. That's my godmom. She has a lot of y'all as far as, like, god kids, but I'm her godson. I just want y'all to know that. Anybody who don't know, I'm going to just let you know that now. She was like everything. Like, she took me in it, and it was just all love from the beginning. Like, I mean, all of the Bryants, like, it was through her. Like, I came over there when it was summertime, and I came to stay the night. Like, it was summertime, and I stayed the entire summer, like off the rip. Like, so, that's like my mom, man. Like, and I live in Atlanta now, so when I got the call, and I talked to Warren, and he was like, he told me I missed the window to talk to. It hurt. And it still hurt, but I had a lot of happy times with her. Like, she was always there. I could talk to her about anything. Everybody know, I know a lot of y'all business, like, for real, all that. But seriously, though, man, like, I'm just gonna miss her, man. I really am, man. I'm really gonna miss her, man. I really am. And I just love you, JB, and just watch over us. And even the Kim, you know, Keena, Juan, I mean, those are her blood kids, and they, you know, took me in too. Of course, Lou, you know, rest his soul also, but like, it's just all love, man. That's all I really gotta say. Thank y'all.
Good evening. I'm Katina. I am one of her goddaughters. Dennis, myself, Tamika, Joy, and a slew of other kids gathered weekends after games, after the football games. We ate moon pies, Dunkin' Donuts. We had a lot of good times together. We got fussed at a lot. Tamika can recall this one incident. We went walking through the neighborhood. She didn't know where we were. When we came back, she got us on the side of the apartment and said, "You don't walk this time of night." She told us all so bad. But we knew that, you know, she would fuss, but we were all okay. And recently when Kim came down for Quan's bridal shower, that was last month, she was waiting on us to leave the hospital. And we thought that she would have the people wheel her down, like, fully dressed. She said, "Y'all gonna come up here and help me get dressed?" We said, "Gotti, why you didn't have the people bring you down?" "No, y'all coming upstairs." So we all parked the car, went upstairs, helped her get dressed, and brought her home. And that's when her and Kim took their ride, the long ride that she took that evening. So, I mean, I am thankful that I was able to assist in advocating for my godmom in her last days to make sure that everything was done for her that she needed done. I am thankful that I was able to do that and that God blessed me to be a blessing to her. So thank you. And I love you, JB.
Is there anyone else? Is there anyone else? Is that someone coming way over there? Okay.
I had to come up here because I've been knowing Miss Janice all my life. She was a constant in my life when my mother worked every day. So many things I remember about her when I was a little girl, just when I kept to myself. So when all of this came and it just hit me on Monday, so I'm playing catch up right now. I did not know she was sick, and it's not my business to know she was sick, but this lady, I remember one homecoming and everyone got escorted out on the field and my mom had to work. And I remember Miss Janice said, she said, "Who got Misa?" And it was just my little thing that she just always, she took account of everyone. I've been at work all week and just trying to stay busy. And I told my teammates, I said, you know, I've been thinking about this lady every day. Just cannot believe it. Just who she was to me from third grade to ninth grade. Every year, she just, you don't know if you were around her, she just made you seem like you were 100%. Just, give me your stuff, go play, I got your stuff. You just, when we were all cheering and afterwards it was chaos, we just getting out of cheerleading clothes and she was just gathering up everyone's stuff and she just kept a count of everything. So Kim McKenna, I love your mama so much. She just meant the world to me, even in my absence. And she would see my mom, she would just say, like, you know, where's Misa? And I just so happy to have had the pleasure to have this woman in my life for so long.
Thank you so much. I'm sure the family appreciates all of those comments and remarks, and I'm sure that there are plenty more to come, but we are just kind of pressed for time. So if you could give me a few minutes to just speak a little bit on behalf of the Word of God, because that's what's going to take us the rest of the way. In coming tonight, when funerals are not really for the person who passed away, they're for the people who are left behind. And it gives everyone an opportunity to say things like was said tonight and to remember and different things like that. But one thing, what makes this particular service unique is that the number of lives that this lady was able to touch. And that's important because many times we look at the person, we think it's the person, and we don't recognize the God in the person. Say amen to that. And so I even tell our congregation all the time, it'll be a great day when people can begin to realize, not only realize, but recognize the manifestation of God in their lives. And he was doing that in her life. And he never changed her personality. He never changed the way she acted. He never changed the way she related to people. He used what she brought to him, and he used it to touch a lot of lives. And it's evident by you being here today. But her daughter said, her daughter Kena said one thing that kind of made me know that I was on the right track and what I was about to say. And she said that on her way home from work, her mother was her ride all the way home for 45 minutes. She could talk 45 minutes. That's real easy for Janice. I mean, 45 minutes, that's no big deal. You know, and then, but then she said, who am I going to talk to now? Who am I going to call when I'm not feeling so well? Who am I going to tell my troubles to? Who am I, who's going to be that special friend for me, or that special thing Mama used to do for me? And so I want to talk to you tonight just for a few minutes about what God is. What God is. And I'm going to use the 23rd Psalm as a text. I'm not going to try to preach the whole text, but there's a couple of verses in this Psalms that, as David writes it, he understands not only who God is, but what God is. And he describes what God is to him. And I don't know how many people in here have a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ, and I don't know how many people in here who don't have a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ, but I'm going to give you a shot to make that happen tonight so that you can understand, because we're all going to have to pass through this way. Amen? So if you have a Bible, whether electronically or paper, go with me to the 23rd Psalm. I'm going to read a couple of verses out of this song, and I'm sure you know it by heart. And then I'm going to deliver what I believe God wants me to say, because this is a word of encouragement, not only to the family, but to all of us. Say amen to that. If you look at what is happening in the world today, it is crazy. The world has gone absolutely mad. And God said it would be mad. God said it would go mad. He said men will become lovers of themselves, and they don't want to love him. And he said that they want to do what they want to do, when they want to do it, and how they want to do it. And there will be no regard for personal safety. There will be no regard for personal, how you treat people. There will be, you can't trust anybody these days. That's just how bad it is. You don't really, there's not a genuine person around anymore that you can call a real friend. There's not people around anymore that will help you and have nothing but good on their mind, but instead trying to use you for some type of thing or for their advantage or something like that. But there is a person. The Bible says he will stick closer than a brother. The Bible says he will be with you ever. He said he promised that he would never leave you or he would never forsake you. And David understood that about his relationship with God. The young man just said his godmama, how she took him in, and he went to stay for one day and stayed the whole summer. That's what God does, because there are things and people missing in the lives of other people, and God will surrogate somebody. I wish I had a witness. He won't come himself, but he'll surrogate somebody to fill in that spot or to fill in that vacancy or to provide what you need at the same time you need it. And it'll be right on the money, right on time. David understood that. And so as he writes this psalm, he begins to help us to understand what God is to him and what God has done for him. And I hope that it does the same thing for us tonight. Say amen to that. I would like to tell her children tonight, before I really get into this, they did a marvelous job in making sure their mother was taken care of. I have nothing but praises for them. They came together like three little musketeers. And even though they all had jobs, they all live out of town, God gave them the ability to coordinate nurses and coordinate things and do things. They did everything they had to do to make sure that their mother was taken care of. And I want to thank her husband, too, Pop. They've been together a long time. You're talking about two peas in a pot right there now. They've been together a long time. I remarried them in my living room. And they've been together ever since. But tonight, let's find out what God is. In Psalms 23, the Bible reads, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want." I could stay right there, but that's not really what I want to talk about. Number two says, "He maketh me to lie down in green pastures." Then it says, "He leadeth me beside the still water." So right off the bat, what is God? He takes care of me. What is God? He's a caretaker for me. When nobody else is around, he is there for me. When I think, when everybody else has left, when everybody else is gone, and that is coming. People going to eat that chicken and rice tomorrow, and they're going to be gone on their way. And it's going to be you, and your brother, and you, and Jesus. And he's going to show you just how much he can take care of you. People don't mean no harm in leaving. They just got to go. But God is going to be a very present help in the midst of the rest of your life while you go through it. Number three says, "He restoreth my soul." He's a restoration God. What is God? God is a restorer. I wish I had a witness. He's a restorer, isn't he, Pop? He can restore you from drugs. He can restore you from alcohol. He can restore you from cocaine. He can restore you from sin. He can restore you from hell. God is a restorer. He can bring you back from where you were to where you need to be. God is a restorer of happiness. He's a restorer of joy. He's a restorer of peace. And whatever else you need, God can be that too, because he's a God of restoration. I was having a lady one day, that brings to my memory a lady who was separated from her father her whole life, never knew who he was, never knew where he was. And it's tough growing up without your parents. But she got saved. She came to love Jesus. And her prayer was, "God, I need to find my daddy. I want to find him. I want to meet him." And God put that thing together. He restored the relationship between her and her father. He restored the relationship between her father and his grandchildren. Now they just like three little peas in a pod. I'm telling you, God is a restorer. I don't know what you're missing in your life. I don't know what has left your life, but God wants to give it back to you. I'm telling you right here tonight that God wants to put you in a place where you should have been and move you from where you are right now, because he is a God of restoration. Verse number four, then he said in verse number four, he says, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me." Death in the text does not mean physical death. Death means tough times, like what we're dealing with right now. Death is when mama gets sick, and then in less than 6 months, she's gone. Death is when I'm praying to God and ask him to heal my mama, but he takes her home anyway. Every now and then I have to walk through the valley, but the valley, he says, "I walk through the valley of the shadow of death." All these things I'm walking through, but they're not affecting me. All these things I'm dealing with, but they're not affecting me. All these things I have to take on and try to maneuver through, he is right there with me every step of the way. Giving me power, giving me strength, giving me whatever I'm lacking to make sure I weather the storm. Say amen to that. God is whatever you need him to be in whatever situation you let him into. You have to let him in, though. If you don't let him in, he won't come. If you don't let him in, he won't talk. If you don't let him in, he won't do a thing. But if you let him in, he comes all the way in. If you let him in, he comes and do whatever thing you need, whatever you need. And if you let him in, the Bible says, weeping may endure for a night, but joy will come in the morning when you let him in. Number five, he says in the text, then he says, I like this, "Thou preparest the table before me in the presence of mine enemies." I don't hide from anybody. I don't have to hide from anybody. He says in the text, "Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies." Not dinner. But it sounds like dinner. What God is saying is, I'm not going to hide how I bless you. I'm going to bless you in the midst of them who hate you. I'm going to bless you in the midst of them who criticize you. And guess what? They're not going to be able to do a thing about it.
They're going to watch me bless you. They're going to watch me deliver you. They're going to watch me set you free. And while they're trying to plot against you, it ain't going to work. While they're talking against you, it does not matter, because I prepared a table for you in the midst of them. So if you don't want God to bless you out loud, don't let him in. If you don't want God to bless you publicly, don't let him in. If you don't want God to show out in your life, don't you let him in. But if you let him in, you better get ready for him to show out. You better get ready for him not only to show out, but to show up. Because God does not know how to do anything but bless your socks off. So he said, thou preparest a table before me. Then he says, he anoints my head with oil. He anoints my head with oil. That's healing. Now, pay close attention. I prayed for God to heal Janice. I know I can get a prayer through. And I know God hear me. I prayed with her children the same prayer. I prayed with her husband the same prayer. My wife and I prayed the same prayer. And some people say, well, she died anyway. No, she was healed. Yeah. She was healed. God knew that the body she was in, I got to teach a little bit now. There was nothing wrong with Janice Bryant's spirit. Her spirit was just as strong, just as alive as it was the day she met Jesus Christ. But her body got sick. And God knew that her body couldn't take no more. And he said, and his decision was, no, she done raised the children like I told her. She been married a long time like I told her. She's raised her grandchildren like I told her. She has done everything I assigned her to do. And Paul says, when you done the work, it ain't nothing to do but go home. There's no need of sticking around when ain't no more work to do. When you finish your assignment, when you have finished what God told you to do, when you have finished your call, when you have done what he said and what he has asked, the next best thing is to get on up out of here. Because Paul says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. All we see right now is the shell that her spirit used while she was on the earth. But Janice is waiting for her new body now, because ain't no cancer in the new body. The lungs don't need to work in the new body. In the new body, she'll be all right. So he says in the text. Verse number 6 is really what I want to talk about. Surely, goodness and mercy shall run with me, follow me. All right. Now, when it comes to verse number 6, he gets a little arrogant. And he gets a little braggadocious. But he has a right to do that because he's bragging on what God is. So when he gets to verse number 6, he says, as if the people reading didn't understand, you would probably say something like, do you feel what I'm saying right now? And if David was here in our language, he would probably say, do you feel what I'm saying? Because in verse number 6, he says, surely. Now God in verse number 6 becomes, surely God is goodness. Surely his goodness. God never travels without his goodness. His goodness and he run hand in hand. They run neck and neck. So David says, I am absolutely convinced that even before I die, that his goodness and his mercy are going to follow me. They trail me. They empower me. They tag along with me. Surely his goodness, surely his mercy shall follow me. Not just one day of my life. You can count on God to be with you all the days of your life. Jesus told his disciples, he says, I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. This is a newsflash to somebody. Somebody here tonight, you think God left you because you start tripping and doing something you ain't had no business. But God can't leave you because he promised he never would. What's going on with you is you fail to hear the Holy Spirit because you're quenching him in your life. You're drowning out his ability to talk to you about what you're doing. Rebellion is like sinking in water. It drowns you and leaves you unable to talk. And that's why the Bible tells us don't quench the Holy Ghost. Because when you quench him, he'll talk, but you can't hear. I wish I had a witness. But David says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And then he backs it up, before and I will dwell. Now, in this particular part of the text, he's talking two-dimensional. He says, goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. And then he says, and I will dwell. In where? In the house of the Lord. How long? He's not only talking about in glory, he's talking about on this side too. I am in God's house on this side. I'm going to be in God's house on that side. Why? Because that's his promise to me. Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you will be also. In other words, I'm going to escort you right back to where your mansion is. I'm going to come and get you in my chariot and roll you right on back to where you need to be. So the text is, what is God? What you need. What do you need? When mama's gone, he'll be there. Dad is gone, he'll be there. Say amen to that. What is God? The Bible says things like he's a bridge over troubled water. Ezekiel says he's a wheel in the middle of a wheel. What is God? He says he's the one that sticks closer than a brother. He's a way out of no way. He's light in the midst of darkness. And he's a very present help in trouble. That's who God is. And that's who he wants to be in every one of our lives. Because when the time comes that we have to face him, Paul told Timothy in his letter, he says, as he wrote that last letter to Timothy, he tells him, he says, I have fought a good fight. I have kept the faith. I have finished my course. Then he says, now, laid up for me is my crown of righteousness, which Jesus Christ, the righteous judge, will present to me personally in that day. I have to believe that Janice is going to be standing right there with Paul to get that crown of righteousness. But now we're still here. Is there a crown waiting for us? Is there a crown that we can expect to receive because we've kept the faith, because we finished the course? Is there a crown for us? Is God pleased with how we're living? Is he pleased with the way that we're carrying ourselves? And there's not a person in here who don't know about God, because he knows about you. And the reason he knows about you is because he made sure that he knows the number of hairs on every one of our heads. So what is God? He's from everlasting to everlasting. The Bible calls him the Prince of Peace. He's the wonderful counselor, the mighty God, the Prince of Peace. But you can just call him Jesus. Mary's baby. The lily of the valley. The bright and morning star. Jesus, Prince, Jesus, the Lamb of God, Jesus, the Savior of the world, Jesus, who sits at the right hand of God. He is all of those things and much, much more. So in the days to come, and you start needing somebody to talk to,
or you need somebody to understand you, there is somebody that knows you better than you know yourself. I invite you. Well, how do I do that, Pastor Hodge? Now, when you're sitting quietly and these thoughts come over your head and your mind about what you're going through, what you're dealing with, and confusion sets in and stress and anxiety sets in, and you don't know what to do, you don't know who to call. Matter of fact, there is nobody to call. This is what I want you to do. Just put your cell phone down. Won't do you no good this time. Right? In your despair, in your test, in the struggle you're in, just cry out, Jesus, help a sister out. Jesus, help a brother out. And he will come right where you are. And he will speak to you. And he will comfort you. And he will bring you through whatever it is that you're going through. Last thing I want to say. Grief is a funny emotion. Because just when we think we're over it, it comes back again. And there'll be days in the future, 5 and 6 and 10 years from now, where the passing of Janice is going to be like it just happened again. So don't think that it's ever going to go away. But you can always count on the presence of God. You can always count on the presence of his power, the presence of his peace, the presence of his love, the presence of his mercy to wrap you in his arms. And what mama used to do, God gonna do it for you. What mama used to say, he'll say it to you. And he'll do it like it's never been done before. Why? Because of Jesus. Because of his death, because of his burial, and because of his resurrection, God has commanded himself to love you and to love me and to provide whatever we need. So we thank God today for Janice Bryant, the lady who wasn't a stranger to anybody, just like Jesus wasn't a stranger to anybody. The lady who made a friend wherever she went, just like Jesus made a friend everywhere he went. The lady who was not afraid to be herself, just like Jesus was not afraid to be himself. He's waiting for somebody to just admit, I need you. I can't do life without you. Give God praise. Give God praise. Now, my goddaughter would say, as she thinks she's giving me pointers, but I always like to give every person an opportunity to make Jesus the Lord of their life. Even in a gathering like this. Because I always say that as one person is going home, or should I say going home, maybe there's someone tonight who wants to come home. Minister Ramsey, would you come down front, please, and stand right here. Minister and Val, would you stand on that side over there? These two men are standing here tonight. If anyone here tonight is thinking about giving Jesus Christ your life, I'm not going to have you stand because you probably think it's going to be embarrassing, even though I don't think it is. But if you're here tonight and you want to give Jesus your life tonight, when we dismiss tonight, just come down front and talk to either one of these gentlemen right here. And they will give you what we call the plan of salvation and explain to you what it involves and then explain what your part in that salvation is. Amen? That's my gift to you tonight. And I do believe if Janice was here, She'd probably be screaming right now. Tell them, Pastor. Tell them about Jesus and what he can do in your life. Give God praise and give God glory. Well, again, thank you all so very much. And on behalf of the family of Janice Bryant and all her relatives, I'm sure we thank you so much for your attendance tonight. This outpouring of love and appreciation to the family is just overwhelming. Thank you so very, very much. I pray God's blessings upon you. If you're traveling and if you're going to be with us tomorrow, we'll be back here again tomorrow as we go through the final leg of this service. Amen. So God bless you. God keep you. This concludes the wake service tonight for Sister Janice Bryant. And if you would stand for the benediction, and then you'll be permitted to go. Let us stand. Now unto him who is able to keep us and present us faultless before an almighty God. Now unto him who is able to deliver us and save us because of his precious blood. Unto Jesus be glory, power, and dominion, not only in this age, but in every age to come. Father, now I pray your blessings upon this family as you by your strength take them through the final leg of this trial in their lives. Equip them now with power. Equip them with strength like you always have and always do. Bless these others in their own unique and special way. We give you praise and we give you thanks. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody that agrees said amen. Amen, amen again. One more time, amen. God bless you.